welcome to Talks at GS. I'm honored to be joined today by Secretary General of the United Nations, António Guterres. He is, of course, now leading the UN in its response to the global coronavirus pandemic. Secretary General Guterres, thank you for joining me during this very busy time.
It's a great pleasure to be here.
You've said that COVID-19 is the greatest test that we've faced together since the formation of the United Nations. Can you put this crisis in perspective for our viewers in terms of other global crises that we've faced or that you've faced and you've confronted throughout your career?
Well, I think this crisis is indeed different and more challenging. First, it's a pandemic, it is clearly the most devastating pandemic we have had since the United Nations was created, in the sense that it's a virus that can transmit easily, so spreads quickly, and with a mortality rate that is not negligible. I mean, it's not like Ebola, that of course would be an absolute global disaster, but it's not negligible. So we have already had more than 250,000 people that died in the world. And it's global. It reaches all countries at the same time. So it's a sudden impact, global, with easy transmission, difficult to control, and non-negligible in the number of people killed. And second, because of its nature and because we do not, I mean, science has developed fantastically in the recent past, but we still do not know how to deal with the virus. We don't know how to kill the virus. We don't know how to prevent the virus. We are, of course, making a huge effort now to get a vaccine, to get treatment, but we are not there. And we don't know when we will be there. And so it is something we don't control. It's a reality we don't control. And being a reality we don't control and with such an impact, the way to respond has largely been to close everything. And closing everything, we are having a devastating impact in the economies and in the societies. And so because of that, it's not only a public health problem, it became the worst economic crisis we had since probably the Great Depression, worse by far than the crisis of 2008. So if you combine the two things, the health emergency with the economic and social emergency, I do believe we are facing the worst crisis we had since the Second World War. And the way out is not yet entirely clear. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, let's be frank. I mean, the international community has demonstrated its fragility. We were not able to put together a common strategy to fight the virus. We do not have a multilateral governance system able to do so. We have the World Health Organization, but they have no teeth. I mean, mm-hmm. they can advise, but they cannot force people to do whatever. And so countries have adopted strategies that are different, sometimes contradictory. The virus moved from China to, I mean, Iran, but then Europe, from Europe to the US. Now it's spreading south. In the south, of course, the virus can have a much more devastating impact because of the lack of health systems capacity. It might come back. We might have second waves. There is a risk of mutation of a virus, and then even a vaccine can. So this is a very dramatic situation, and it proved the fragility of our world and the fragility of our institutions. If this is a global challenge, we don't have global mechanisms to address it. Our multilateral government system is very weak. It's very funny, because in a world where multilateralism is to put into question, our problem is not to have an excessive multilateralism. Our problem is that we do not have multilateral governance systems able to organize the international community to fight something as simple as a virus.
Yeah, it's really well said. And you know, as you talked about it and as you pointed out throughout this pandemic, it's really very much a human crisis. And, you know, I'd like you to talk a little bit about that. You said recently that a human crisis that is fast becoming a human rights crisis. And so how can we be thinking about the human element of this? You know, you talked about the virus, you talked about the economics, but talk a little bit about the human impact that we have to confront with this pandemic.
Well, I mean, people are living in a different way. We are facing a serious problem of mental health to which we are also very ill-equipped to deal with. We are, again, When we had a financial crisis, the essential thing was to make sure that there would be liquidity in the financial system and everything else would trickle down. In this kind of crisis, you need to deal with households and you need to deal with businesses and you need to make sure that you keep households and businesses afloat, which means that you have to target your economic measures to people, not only to institutions or to companies. On the other hand, we see also that this pandemic, creating mechanisms of control that are not usual, is giving authoritarian states the reason to, especially taking now profit of what technology allows, the digital world, the artificial intelligence, is giving states the possibility to establish mechanisms of control that, in my opinion, are a serious threat to human rights. And we are seeing it already working. It was there before the COVID, but COVID provides a justification for it. And I hope this will not translate itself into a change in the relation between people and state institutions, especially in the areas where authoritarianism has been increasing in recent times, together with other forms of populism, etc. So in all these dimensions, there is a complexity, which is the human complexity. All aspects of human nature are being impacted, from the health crisis to the economic and social situation, but living at the level of the household, to the problems of mental health, to the questions of the preservation of human rights in a situation where controls in society have been increasing quite dramatically.
Let's turn more to the economic impact. You know, in the context of that, you've announced the formation of a COVID-19 response and recovery fund. Here in the U.S., the government continues to pass the largest relief packages in history. How do you think about, you know, the ability to do this on a global scale, particularly in countries, even wealthy countries, that haven't had the ability in the past to pass similar relief packages?
I don't think we have enough firepower for that. Yeah. And I think it will be necessary to mobilize it. And as we will see more and more countries with a dramatic liquidity situation, especially middle-income countries of large dimension, we will see the need to do it. I think we should distinguish two kinds of instruments. Mm-hmm. There are instruments like the ones that we have launched, the global humanitarian package, this fund for responsible recovery that you mentioned. These are small instruments allowing for immediate responses to emergency situations in very vulnerable societies, in very difficult areas, but that are relatively small compared with what is needed to keep afloat the largest economies of the developing world and to make sure that we do not have a series of insolvencies that can have a structural impact that would be devastating. I think that would require a stronger firing power from the International Monetary Fund, and it requires a strategy about debt. And I believe there was a measure about, as you know, a standstill until the end of the year for debt payments in relation to 25 of the least developed countries. But I think we will need to amplify that to a number of other countries that are developing countries or middle-income countries and at a certain moment have no capacity to have access to the financial markets. And then I think we need to also find some forms of debt alleviation that require a large effort of cooperation between International Monetary Fund and the international financial institutions, the governments, and also the private sector, to have a strategy allowing to avoid this to transform itself into the kind of succession of bankruptcies or insolvencies that can lead to a structural crisis that it will be very difficult to overcome. How to do it, you know better than me, but I feel that there must be a serious concertation of efforts between international financial institutions, governments, and the private sector to look on how to do it in the smoothest possible way, not, of course, creating a mechanism of in which everything is possible and there is no accountability, but in the smoothest possible way to move through this dramatic situation without a total disruption of our financial sectors globally.
Do you, you know, you talk about, and I agree, there's got to be, the private sector has to play a coordinating role. Do you have some specific ideas on some things that the private sector should be more focused on at this point?
No, I think the private sector is doing a lot at the present moment. I see a lot of companies that are shifting their strategies in order to be able to play a positive role. I mean, I see a lot of investment, for instance, in the pharmaceutical sector to try to develop vaccines, to try to develop treatments, testing mechanisms. I see different institutions, I believe, like your own, advising governments on how to deal with this and helping them to have coherent strategies to face a social crisis and an economic crisis like the one we are having. So I believe the private sector is doing a lot. Not what I think is more important from the private sector is not to give money, is to provide expertise, is to give what the private sector knows how to do better, and allowing governments, allowing civil societies to be able to use that expertise in fighting the disease, but also in creating the conditions for minimizing the social and economic impacts of the crisis, and to prepare a recovery that we hope will be better than what we had in the past.
Yeah. One group that's been disproportionately affected by the economic impact of the crisis is women. And you had pointed out recently that nearly 60% of the women around the world work in the informal economy, the less structured part of the economy. How should governments be thinking about economically empowering women as we address the crisis?
I think we need a comprehensive strategy for that, because women are indeed the most dramatically impacted by the crisis. First, as you mentioned, the majority of women that are employed are in the informal sector. When we see the jobs that were lost, there is a majority of women in the jobs that were lost. When we see some jobs that are being recreated now, with more men are coming back to work than women in these last 2 weeks. So again, all the system is distorted in a way that is discriminatory in relation to women. If you look at the health sector, the majority of the people in the health sector are women, and the majority of the victims in the health sector are women. And on the other hand, if you look at the situation of the lockdowns and the people at home, there has been a dramatic increase in domestic violence. We believe that the increase is depending on the situation in each society, but it can go from 10 or 15% to the double. We just had a report from Russia that is very, very worrying. And so I believe we need a comprehensive strategy of empowerment, as you said, to change social relations in order for women to gain what they need and what they deserve to the benefit of the whole society. I am a true believer in gender parity. We managed to have in the 1st of January, for the first time in the history of our organization, full gender parity in the senior management of the UN, 90 men and 90 women. I know that Goldman Sachs doesn't allow a company or doesn't support companies to go public if they have not women in their boards. And I know that you have made a huge effort in relation to the empowerment of women, namely women entrepreneurs through training, through financial support. And you consider that a key element of your strategy. And I am a true believer that the world has a lot to benefit if we have a much stronger participation of women in the workforce, in the boards of companies, in the governments, the parliaments, all structures of the society. And if we organize the way societies work and the way the economies work, in order for the empowerment of women to be a key priority in the action of governments and in the action of the different entities that compose our societies and our economies.
That's definitely something that we, that's definitely something I agree wholeheartedly with, and it's something we've got to continue to strive for and try to continue to make progress on.
Well, my experience, if I may, my experience, I participated in governments, I participated in organizations, the most different ones in the private sector. whenever you have a decision-making body in which there is a rather, I mean, a certain equilibrium of gender, the quality of the decisions systematically improves.
Yeah, yeah. We before we got on and started talking, you and I were just talking a little bit about the reopening of the economy. Talk a little bit and give our viewers, you know, your sense of what the economy might look like when it reopens, both in the near term, but over a longer period of time.
Well, I think that in the near term, the most important is to find the best ways to reopen the economy without risking the pandemic to have second waves, which means we need, in the short term, to be smart in the way we do things. But in the long term, I think the key question is whether or not we are able to have an economy that is more sustainable and more inclusive. I believe that you have now a very strong commitment of, if I'm correct, $750 billion U.S. dollars in financing, advisory, investment, in both climate transition and inclusive growth. And this is the central question. Will we be able or not, to recover in a way that is greener and to recover in a way that is more inclusive? It is very interesting that if one looks at the first quarter, there was a huge decrease in energy demand, but the demand of renewable energy increased by 1.5%, which means that it is clear where the future is. Are we going to be able to anticipate the future and to use this opportunity to anticipate the future, or are we going to drag an inevitable transition with all the costs that that has? And on the inclusivity point of view, I think it is clear that the stronger societies are, the stronger the social cohesion of societies, the better the capacities to resist to a pandemic or to climate change or to any other of the challenges we face. And so I think to address the problems of inequality, to address the problems of inclusivity, of women, of different areas of the population is absolutely essential. And sometimes people look into the question of inequality related to extreme poverty. As a matter of fact, extreme poverty has been reduced in the recent decades. Unfortunately, we might have a big increase now because of the COVID. But I think the most dramatic challenge for the societies is with the squeezing of the middle class we were witnessing. And with the fact that that squeezing and the difference between expectations and realities was creating in the world a situation of mistrust between people and institutions, governments, but also other institutions, that in my opinion was a serious threat to the stability of our democracies and to the cohesion of our societies. And so I think that to build or to rebuild or to build back in a more sustainable way and at the same time in a more inclusive way is a challenge we all face. And I believe governments, the private sector, the civil society, the academia, everybody needs to try to see how we can use this opportunity to anticipate what in any case would be an inevitable transition and to make it more smooth and more fair for all of us.
One of the things that you and I, you know, talked about is the horrifying global surge in domestic violence and how both our health system but also the pandemic is accelerating some of these issues. Some countries have seen the number of women calling support services double. What needs to be done so that the strain, more specifically, we were talking about these vulnerabilities, but what can be done so the strained public health system around the world can do a better job supporting, you know, victims of this kind of domestic violence?
I think the health system is important. And of course, it means more capacity in the kind of safe houses, more capacity in the kind of mental health treatment, more capacity in all those aspects. But I think the key question is still a question of power. 20 years ago, I was Prime Minister of Portugal, and one of the most difficult things we had was a campaign in order to put domestic violence in the center of the concerns. There was a state of denial. The society rejected that the problem existed. The police was not very active on that. Neighbors would not pay attention to what was happening close by. Judges would not be active enough. And so I think we need a very strong belief that this is a serious problem in our societies, with COVID or without COVID. And we need really to do some fundamental reforms in our justice systems, in the way our police are trained, in the way I would say there is a way to sensitize communities, to have themselves a capacity to prevent these situations. And this is something that must be a key priority in the policies defined by governments and the key priorities in the actions of civil society, and where the private sector can also have an important positive role. Beyond that, of course, you have all the questions of mental health. Mental health is, I would say, the less invested area of our public health system.
Great.
And this is a big mistake.
Yeah.
Because if there is a cause of suffering in the world, I believe depression is probably the biggest cause of suffering in the world. My first wife that passed away was a psychoanalyst. My sister is a psychiatrist. I've lived those things very strongly. And when I was in government, I felt them very dramatically. I feel them now here in the UN. What for me is terrible, when we see the situations of trauma in conflict areas, with refugee situations, our capacity to deal with the mental health problems of those vulnerable populations is extremely reduced. And even in our societies, in our developed societies, mental health is the less invested area of our public health systems.
Yeah, yeah. Another group that's been disproportionately impacted is refugees. And, you know, given your previous role at the UN for 10 years as the High Commissioner of Refugees, you're certainly familiar with that crisis. Can you talk a little bit about how the pandemic is exacerbating, you know, the refugee crisis and how we should be thinking about that?
Well, first of all, pandemic is closing borders.
Mm-hmm.
And by definition, refugees need borders to be open.
Yeah.
And there is a lot of prejudice in relation to refugees. I mean, a lot of confusion, namely between refugees, migration, and other displacement and other concepts. My experience is that refugees are people fleeing dramatic situations of violence. And I think when one looks at the world today, it is essential to keep doors open for refugee situations. Of course, when we have a country like the US that has a resettlement program that has been reduced in the recent past, refugees that come to the US are scrutinized from the security point of view more than anybody else. So, of course, there are risks when people enter a country. But if there is someone that is scrutinized, and it takes months and months, and I've witnessed that myself, are refugees to enter this country. Of course, now with the COVID, there are mechanisms to verify that whoever comes is. So, first of all, we need to lose this prejudice that refugees are going to invade us and are going to create problems and are going to be a threat to our security, and to keep, with all the precautions that are necessary, borders open to people in need of protection. And second, to address the dramatic situation of refugees that are in developing countries, in refugee camps or in urban settings that usually are the slums of the big cities, and to have a very strong priority in preventing the COVID to come to them. The High Commissioner for Refugees and the organization, International Organization for Migration, have a very important program to do it. They are cooperating with governments, but of course the risks are enormous. And my strong appeal in relation to the humanitarian programs that we have launched is for priority to be given in the support to the situations in refugee camps and in refugee settings whose vulnerability is absolutely enormous, because it will be very difficult to separate people. They are concentrated in very small spaces.
You've said that with solidarity, we can defeat the virus and build a better world. Talk a little bit about how this moment could really be used to bring the world together in solidarity in a way that helps us all for a brighter future. Because that is really what we should be trying to do.
I think that is what we need to do. We are not yet there, unfortunately, because of the contradiction that exists in the global political situation, but we absolutely need it. I think it now became clear that we have a huge fragility in relation to pandemic. It is clear that we have a huge fragility in relation to climate change. It is clear that we have still very meaningful fragilities in relation to disarmament and in relation to proliferation. Look at the nuclear arms, risk of proliferation, and the chemical weapons, risk of proliferation. This has shown how biological weapons can become a major global threat. So the fragilities are huge. And let's be clear. I mean, either we come together and address together these fragilities, or if we use them to a certain extent, threaten each other, we are doomed.
Yes. Well, let's hope for the better. I really appreciate your being with us today. It's really been a pleasure having you at Talks with GS. Thank you for taking time out. I know that you've got a lot that you're focused on, but it's really great to have you participate, and I look forward to seeing you face-to-face instead of seeing you on a screen sometime in the near future when we get to a better place. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you very much. It was a big pleasure, and best success in your commitments in relation to sustainability and inclusivity. And as we all talk about a transition, let's all make the transition as quick as possible.
Let's hope so. Thank you for your time, and have a great day.
Thank you.
Good to see you.
Thank you.